There. Okay, so this is lecture 20 once again, and so the last thing we were seeing were things like coding gain and capacity and all that. I'm not sure if that sunk in very well, but I think it's not too crucial in this course, but you should know that there is such a notion. Okay, so the crucial idea was there is at least for BPSK over AWGN. Okay, there is something called capacity. Okay, maybe it's denoted C. It is some function of what? SNR. Right? That much I was able to say. So what is capacity? Capacity is a rate. In this case, since it's BPSK, capacity is going to be between 0 and 1. Right? So it's the rate at which you can transmit. C is going to be a function of SNR. It's a monotonically increasing function. I even showed you a plot, right? From 0 to 1, you can actually calculate it and plot it if you want. Okay? So usually you think of fixing the SNR and what's the maximum rate at which you can transmit. Okay? But there's also the dual or the other way of looking at it with the inverse of this. So this function is nice, monotonically increasing and all that. So obviously the inverse will exist. Okay? So if you invert it, you'll get SNR as some inverse function of C. Okay. Suppose you know you want to transmit at a particular rate, what is the minimum SNR that you need for achieving what? Arbitrarily low probability of error. What do you mean by achieving? I mean, again, you don't know if you're going to achieve it or not, but that at least you know that there exists a code which will achieve arbitrarily low probability of error. Okay. So this is called the SNR achieving a capacity, etc. So both views are the same. So that's why for rate half, for instance, I said the minimum SNR you need is some 0 dB, 0.2 dB. Okay, so that is the idea. Okay, you can also view it that way. Okay, coding gain is kind of defined in this form. Okay, so for instance, we said C equals half implies SNR is greater than or equal to say some 0.2 dB. Right? So this was one point I gave you. What was it for uncoded? For uncoded, you wanted an SNR of around 13 dB for getting 10 power minus 6 bit error rate. Okay? So if you say arbitrarily low bit error rate is the same as 10 power minus 6, okay, then you see with coding, one can potentially get a big reduction in SNR. But the problem with this is you're not accounting for the rate normalization. When you do rate half, you're spending more energy and you're actually using the channel more. Okay, so you have to normalize with respect to that. After you normalize, the right way of doing it is in terms of EB over N0. Okay, so all you have to do is take this formula and say so this SNR is actually capacity achieving SNR. Okay, so likewise, the capacity achieving EB over N0 will be what? Will be, what do you do to SNR to get EB over N0? You divide by 2 times rate, okay? So how do you do that? 1 by 2 C, F inverse C, okay? So this is a very simple way of moving to EB over N0 if you will. And then you can normalize with respect to this and then compute SNR. For C equals half, there is no difference, right? Notice for C equals half, what happens? I mean, it's going to cancel with that and you don't get anything. So it's not a big deal. So you can even think of EB over N0 as the same thing as SNR. But uncoded, EB over N0 will come down. Okay, for EB over N0, for uncoded systems, what do you need? Around 10.5 dB, you can get 10 power minus 6. Okay, is that clear? So for uncoded, EB over N0 is about, let's say, 11 dB. Okay, just to give you a round number for 10 power minus 6 BER. Okay, so for rate half, EB over N0 is greater than or equal to, let's say, around 0.2 dB. Okay, for maybe even 10 power minus 6 BER. Arbitrarily low is what we know, but let's say 10 power minus 6. Okay, so so you notice for error-free transmission, around 10 dB of coding gain is possible. Okay, what do I mean by that? In the BER versus EB over N0 plot, okay, in the BER versus EB over N0 plot, the uncoded curve will hit 10 power minus 6 at around 11 dB. You can have an actual code for which the curve will hit 10 power minus 6 at close to 0.2 dB. Okay, so that difference is the coding gain. Okay, so around 10 dB or 11 dB of coding gain, 10 dB I think, let's keep it as 10 dB. 10 dB of coding gain is possible by constructing a good rate half code. And as I told you, really recently people have constructed rate half LDPC codes which can get very, very close to this point. Okay, so 10 dB, that's a huge coding gain, even accounting for the rate normalization. Okay, so that is the, I think that is, that should be more than enough for this class, that notion of capacity, the fact that capacity is important and all that. Okay, any questions on this? And I also showed you as a simple calculation that for the repetition code, you won't get any coding gain, right? I showed you those two simple calculations. So let's see a few more plots. Okay. Okay, so I'll start with the Hamming code. Okay, so you know the Hamming code, right? So how do I zoom? So, there should be something to zoom, no? Yeah, we can maximize. Thanks. Can you see it better now? Is that better? Reasonably clear? Okay. So that's a BER versus EB over N0 plot for the Hamming code, for the 7-4 Hamming code. Okay. So the simplest code out there. Okay. So I've plotted three curves. One I've said is uncoded. Okay. This is the uncoded guy. Okay. This one is the uncoded one. So maybe what I should do is I should insert it into the Windows journal, right? Let me do that. I think then I can write on top of it. Can you see the removable disk? Okay, so that's nice. Okay, so that's the EB over N0 plot. Can you see it? You can see it, right? Okay. So this guy is the uncoded. Okay, the uncoded curve. Okay, maybe you can't see the colors very clearly. Okay, and this one is the maximum likelihood decoding for the Hamming code, the green curve. Okay, so this is the maximum likelihood decoding for Hamming code. So soft maximum likelihood decoding. Okay, so you can see, well, you can't see the numbers here very clearly. I've said coding gain at BER of 10 power minus 3 is around 1 dB. Okay, on top of, maybe I took the wrong curve for the coding gain. Okay, so this is not correct. Maybe it's not 1 dB, it's less than 1 dB. Okay, so I guess, as 10. Yeah, so Hamming code will not give you that much. Okay, so I'm sorry. Yeah, I'll comment on. Okay, so you see that's the coding gain. I've somehow taken the wrong distance there. So you see this is the coding gain for the Hamming code. I have to look at it with respect to the uncoded picture. Okay, can you see a lot of the screen seems to be, I mean, is that because of the picture or is it that always? Projector, is it? Yeah, it's pretty bad. I have to make that change. Okay, anyway, so that's the coding gain. So, Hamming codes, while I mean, so, but this is, remember, this is hard decision, soft decision ML decoding. So what should I do? How is soft decision ML decoding done for the Hamming code? What do? You've forgotten soft decision maximum likelihood decoding. What do you do? Yeah, you do correlations. How many correlations do I have to do? 2 power. So it's a 7-4 code. So you have to do 2 power 4, right? 16 code words. So 16 symbol vectors. You have to correlate the received vector with 16 other vectors and pick that one which give you the maximum correlation. So it's quite complex. It's not a simple decoder. Okay. On the other hand, the syndrome decoder for the Hamming code is very simple, but it's a hard decision decoder, right? You have to make a hard decision first and then do the syndrome decoding, and that is this plot. This plot is the hard decision. So you see hard decision syndrome decoder, and you see that is not giving you that much coding gain. So doing hard decision is quite suboptimal. Okay, in fact, it's not giving you any gain at all up to some point, and after some time it's crossing over. Okay, so eventually at very high SNRs, at very high SNRs it will give you some coding gain, but low SNRs it's not going to give you coding gain, it's going to give you a loss. What's the question? It's not becoming better. At no point is it better than soft decision. Yeah, the green curve is sufficiently far away. Okay, the uncoded is crossing over with the hard decision decoder. So that can happen, you know. I mean, the hard decision is quite suboptimal, and the uncoded can be better than that. Okay. So so you're saying, okay, so will you see this crossing over that happens all the time? I don't know, it depends on the code. But yeah, I mean, at lower EB over NOTs, there's really not much coding gain to get. Okay. In general, it will happen, but it will, yeah. I'd say yes, there's at lower BERs, higher EB over NOTs, there's possibility for slightly larger coding gain. Okay. So, yeah, so I'm going to talk about that next. Okay, so how do you think I got this plot? Okay, so how did I do correlation with 16 vectors and figure out what the error was? I mean, of course, I can't do any analysis, right? It's not possible. So this plot was obtained by simulation. Okay, so I generate a lot of code words. I do the BPSK modulation. I add Gaussian noise. I transmit it across. I mean, so basically do the whole thing in MATLAB. Okay, add noise vectors, do the correlation, and count the number of bit errors that actually happened. Okay, and then divide the number of bit errors divided by the total number of bits transmitted. I get bit error rate at a particular EB over NOT. Okay, it's a very easy simulation to do. At least for the Hamming code, it's an easy simulation. Otherwise, it's tough. Okay, so that's how I got this plot. But the uncoded curve, you can obtain. And in fact, even the hard decision, you can get an expression. That's why it goes all the way down below to 10 power minus 6. And the ML curve stops at 10 power minus 3. Why did I stop at 10 power minus 3? Yeah, see, if to get a particular bit error rate reliably, I need good statistics from simulation. So I should get at least 100 errors, right? Unless I get 100 errors, I can't really say anything. If I have to get 100 errors, how many bits do I have to send at 10 power minus 3 bit error rate? 10 power 5, right? So I have to do a lot of simulations, a lot of computer time, okay? So I don't want to do such a kind of simulation, so I stop at some point, okay? So when you do simulation, all these things become important. Okay, so let me come back to his question. So you were saying, can we say that linear codes will achieve capacity? Yeah, for binary symmetric channels, even for binary input AWGN channels, one can argue linear codes are enough. Okay, anyway, so that's the plot for the Hamming code. It's, you might say it's a simple enough code, but at least giving you something, right? For the repetition code, you might be totally disappointed saying it lies on top of the uncoded curve. But Hamming code, it's a simple enough code. It's giving us something, so it's not too bad. Okay. So the next picture that I want to show you is for other codes. Some we have seen in the class, some we have not seen. Okay. So this graph is not from my simulation. It's a book on convolutional codes by Zsigangirov and I think somebody else. I'm not sure. It's from a book. think it's fundamentals of convolutional codes. Okay, stare at the picture for a while and try to make your conclusions. So you have uncoded BPSK, okay, then EB over N0 in DB on the x-axis, 10 power minus 6. So you notice everybody does the same thing, okay. So 10 power minus 6 is the real point, and then you have EB over N0. You see the uncoded line cuts it around 11 dB, okay, 10.5, I guess. That's where it cuts it. And okay, so this code you might know. What is this code? 256192, right? 3x4 Reed Solomon code. Okay, I believe that's hard decision decoding. Okay, and what is that doing? That's cutting the EB over N0 axis at 10 power minus 6 at around 6 dB. So you're getting about 4 dB of coding gain with a Reed Solomon code. Okay. And then there are this whole bunch of things named as Viterbi, okay. So those are convolutional codes, okay. So we have not talked about it. We'll talk about it after we do LDPC codes. But those are convolutional codes. And these lines are all capacity, okay. So R equals 3x4, 0.86 dB is the capacity. Okay, R equals 1/2, approximately 0 dB is the capacity, okay. Forget about the R equals 0 line. It's not too relevant to us, okay. So you see, while a coding gain of close to 10 dB is possible even at R equals 3/4, your good old Reed Solomon codes are able to give you only about 4 dB of coding gain. There's still another 5 to 6 dB which is out there, which the Reed Solomon codes are not able to give. Okay, so you need other techniques, and even the Viterbi codes and convolutional codes are going down to 5 dB, but they're not able to go down to 1 dB, 2 dB. Those kind of numbers you're not able to see with convolutional codes and Reed Solomon codes. Okay. In fact, for a long time, people believed that it's not possible to do any better. No, you can't really get all this coding gain in practice. Okay. Till the recent rediscovery and discoveries of turbo codes and LDPC codes, all these were not considered possible. Okay. Yeah, so, oh, forget about that curve really. I mean, just look at this line. Forget about the curve. Okay, the capacity is 0 dB and 0.86 dB. Okay, that curve, forget about those lines. Those lines are not relevant to us. Okay. Okay. So, Reed Solomon codes are not bad, you know. I mean, so you don't have to be worried, so upset about using Reed Solomon codes. They give you good coding gain. They don't give you great coding gain, but it's okay. It's not too bad. And convolutional codes, we'll see. I mean, convolutional codes are also very easy to implement. They're not very bad, but they don't give you too much coding gain. Okay. Okay. So you should get used to this kind of a picture. Okay. So from now on, most of the analysis we do will be based on simulation mostly. Okay. And many of the motivations will come from simulation. Let's say in simulations we observe that this is what happens, you know. So that's how many of the analysis will come from now on, and you should know how to get this kind of a plot. Given any code and given any decoder, you should be able to simulate it and get this plot. Okay, it's very easy to do that. You know the definition of EB over N0, you know the definition of bit error, right? So just simulate and get the curve. If you can analyze, yeah, it's great. Even if you cannot, this is good enough. Okay. Any questions on these kind of things? So, what I want to tell you by all this is, there is some hope out there even for traditional codes. They give you some coding gain, but if you really, really want to get to capacity, you have to do something more. Okay. So, for instance, we've been designing Reed Solomon codes keeping distance as the main criteria, right? Minimum distance was a criteria. We wanted to get as close as possible to the best possible minimum distance. You do that. You do all your codes, even if you do BCH codes, you'll see they'll be around 5 dB only. So BCH codes and Reed Solomon codes have great minimum distance properties, but they don't give you the coding gain necessary to take you to capacity. Okay, what we do from now on, when I define LDPC codes, you'll see it's one of the most strange definitions out there. There is absolutely no concern about the parity check matrix. In fact, we'll say we'll generate the parity check matrix randomly. Okay, so you remember the care and concern we took to generate the BCH and Reed Solomon parity check matrices.
for LDPC codes, I'll say we generated randomly. Okay, and you'll see that will give you a performance that pushes you to the coding game. Okay, it's kind of very contradictory at the end of the day. The trick there is has got to do with the proof of capacity. Okay, so I'll briefly mention that before I introduce what LDPC codes are, and we'll see some basic definitions. So proof of capacity is the key to most of these things. So proof of capacity involves what are called random codes. Okay, it does not involve Reed-Solomon codes or LDPC codes. What do I mean by random codes? Well, you basically generate the code at random. So you take, for instance, a generator matrix and put random entries for each bit, 0 or 1. Okay, if you do that, it turns out many codes are good. No, many codes end up being good. Many random codes end up being very good in terms of from a capacity point of view. Those are things that you can show. Okay, if I have to show it, it's a long derivation. Maybe it's not so great, but one thing that people knew for a long time is any random code is good when you make the block length very large. Okay, suppose I want rate half codes. As I keep making block length very large, I don't have to worry so much about constructing the parity check matrix very carefully. I can generate it at random. In many cases, it will be good. Okay, that was also known. But what is the problem in implementing that in practice? Suppose I generate a random 0 and 1, what is the problem? Decoding is a problem. How do you decode? Okay, whenever you say those codes are good, you assume ideal decoders. Either the soft input ML decoder or the hard input ML decoder. But decoding is a big problem. You can't decode. That is why Reed-Solomon codes are very nice. All the structure helps you in the decoding. But if you do random codes, you can in fact do way better than Reed-Solomon codes. Get close to capacity in many cases. If you can decode, correct. If you can do the decoding. So that was a problem. Okay. So I know I have not proved this to you, but take that as an axiom. Okay. So if you construct a code at random, it's very likely to be good. Except that you can't decode it. So the main motivation behind this LDPC codes and all that is, can we have a code as random as possible, but still decodable? Okay. In fact, even decodable by some approximate algorithm, soft decodable. Can it get close enough to the optimal algorithm, and then can we claim that it will get to capacity? Okay, so that will be the logic. Okay, and it will seem strange at many places because it will deviate a lot from the very rigorous way in which we've been constructing parity check matrices. But believe me when I tell you, when you actually implement it and see the BER versus EBR and not plot, these codes will be way better than the Reed-Solomon codes and the convolutional codes that have been designed taking a lot of care. Okay, so so let me write just a few lines to tell you how it works. It's also known that many random codes are good. Many random codes can well, I'll say can approach capacity. At large block lengths. When I say many, you know what I mean is you just generate any one random code randomly, there is a good probability that it will get you close to capacity. So suppose if you can decode it well, what would you do? Just generate one random code after the other, do your BER versus EBR and not plot and check which one is close to capacity. You'll quickly find one that is close to capacity. Okay, that's what it means when I make this statement. Okay, quickly in the sense you'll eventually find it. No, that's the thing. Yes. I don't know. I don't think there is a connection between entropy and this. There are other. I don't want to make such connections. Okay. So it's more of a combinatorial property. It's just that when you generate it at random, it'll work well. That's all. Okay. So this was also known, and the modern codes. Okay. What is the problem? The problem is decoding. Okay. Problem with random codes is decoding. Decoding. Okay, so implementable decoding is very, very hard. So in modern codes, the approach taken is the following. Okay, so you might say maybe this is not a very satisfying approach, but at least it gets you to capacity. Okay, the modern codes, okay, have a random part in their construction.
Okay. So, okay, they have a random part in their construction and decoding is efficient. Well, efficient within quotes. Efficient in today's technology. Okay. You can build chips and you can write code on in DSP or whatever to decode these things very fast. Okay, so that's what is mean. That's what I mean when I say efficient. Okay. So the philosophy is very different. Yeah, ideally it would be great if I can have a deterministic nice construction like the Reed-Solomon codes, which will also take you to capacity. But it seems like so far people have not succeeded in doing that. If you have nice deterministic constructions, then it's not taking you close to capacity with efficient decoders. If you have these kind of pseudo random like constructions, then you have efficient decoders and then you go to capacity. Okay, so there is a certain degree of trust required, and there's also analysis possible for these codes. Okay, so I'll hint at how to analyze it, and maybe one or two analysis the steps we'll do in detail. It's not possible to do the entire thing in great detail. Okay, so this is kind of a prelude to this soft decode, and this prelude to what we're going to see next, LDPC codes. And if you want to gather all the thoughts together, we have moved slowly away from BSC to BPSK OIWGN. We have worried about capacity and seen what's the maximum possible coding gain. And then we have seen very quickly that the traditional codes don't take you very close to capacity. And then given you loose arguments for why some degree of randomness might be needed in your code construction so that you can get close to capacity. Okay, so it's not very rigorous, and unless you do a whole bunch of theory carefully, it's difficult to make it rigorous also. So gone through very fast and giving you some motivation. Okay, so with all that background, let's move into low density parity checkers. Okay, so the shortened version for the name is LDPC codes. Okay, so I'll give you the definition. It will be very surprising. It's really nothing to really define for LDPC codes. Not like Solomon codes. They don't have a specific parity check matrix. Okay, so a linear code. Let me say why do I say any? It may not confuse you too much. Okay, a linear code with a sparse parity check matrix. What do we mean by sparse? Parity check matrix is said to be an LDPC code. Okay, so what is sparse? Sparse is very few ones. Okay, lots of zeros. Okay. So, I mean, there's nothing in this definition, right? So, how do you construct an LDPC code? How do you construct an LDPC code? Let's take a parity check matrix, put a few ones here and there, okay? You get an LDPC code, okay? But it's not that every LDPC code will be good, okay? So, we can't say all that, okay? It's because I put a few ones, I can't expect my code to be any good, right? For instance, if I have an all zero column, what will happen? Obviously, the code will not be good, okay? So, there are further classifications, careful study to figure out which of these LDPC matrices are very likely to be good, okay? Again, we won't have a deterministic construction which says this one will be good, but we'll say if your sparseness of your parity check matrix is sparse, and in addition, it looks like this, it satisfies some further constraints, then it is very likely to be good. That is the kind of statement that we'll make. Okay. Very different from the usual statements that you saw in terms of minimum distance and all that. Okay. So one such low density parity check matrix construction, which has produced reasonably good codes, not the best possible LDPC codes, but quite good LDPC codes, is what's called the regular construction. Okay. So we'll concentrate a lot on regular codes. Okay. Regular LDPC codes. Okay, so regular LDPC codes are parameterized by three quantities. Okay, one is the block length n. Okay, what makes it regular is, I'll say each column of my parity check matrix has to have the same weight. Weight as in same number of ones. Okay, that will be my regularity imposition. Okay, so I need that common weight for all the columns. Okay, so that I'll call WC, which is the weight of each column. Okay, so regular LDPC codes, let me say the parity check matrix is H. Okay, not only that, in addition I'm going to say each row of my parity check matrix should also have a constant weight, and that constant weight I'll call WR. Okay, so these are the three parameters that will define my parity check matrix, and it has to be sparse. How will I make it sparse? WC and WR should be small compared to N. Okay, in comparison to N, WC and WR should be small. Then I'll have very few ones in my parity check matrix. Why have I not specified the number of rows? I'm going to say these three are enough to tell me how many rows my parity check matrix will have. Why is that true? Okay. So given N and WC and WR, you can actually calculate the number of rows. How will you calculate that? Okay, so the trick to that is to count the total number of ones in your parity check matrix, row wise and column wise. What's the number of parity ones in the parity check matrix column wise? WC times N. What's the number of ones in the parity check matrix counted row wise? Number of rows times WR, and both of those have to be equal, right? Otherwise then something has gone wrong in your construction. So the number of rows has to be equal to what? N times WC divided by WR. Immediately that means what? I can't pick WC and WR to be arbitrary numbers. It depends on N also. Right? N times WC by WR should be an integer. Okay, number of rows should be an integer. I can't have 2.5 rows. Okay, so it doesn't work. Okay, so these three are enough to tell me number of rows of H equals N times WC by WR. This has to be an integer. Okay, it cannot be rational. Okay, so you have a given a block length N and WC. There are some constraints on WR. You can't pick all possible WR. Only those which will divide the product N times WC is possible. Okay. Okay. So the next question is, do these three numbers completely define the parity check matrix, or do they define a set of parity check matrices? A set of parity check matrices. That is clear, right? Just because I give you the weight and column weight and row weight, I cannot say I've completely defined my parity check matrix. Okay? I can have more than one parity check matrix H which satisfies all these three constraints. Okay? So that will be the degree of the level of randomness in my code. I'll say I don't care about the exact code that you pick with these parameters. Pick any code with these parameters, it's very likely to be good. That's the kind of statement that we'll make. Okay, so that's that will be the randomness in this regular LDPC construction. Okay, so let's see some examples. The most common let's see some examples. Maybe I'll go to the next page to see some examples. Okay, the most common value for WC, the weight of the columns, will be 3. Okay, so usually you pick it to be 3. 2 is too low, you pick it to be 3. Okay, and N is usually not given so much importance. Okay, the reason is you want to be able to go to larger and larger block lengths. Okay, so you'll see N is not so crucial. Okay, so whatever block length you have, it's going to be very large. So
n will usually not, will not bother too much about the block length. Okay, so we'll only worry about usually wc and wr. Okay, and suppose I say I want a particular rate r. Okay, suppose my rate is going to be, say, some capital R. Okay, is it clear? Okay, so we'll fix usually wc, which is the weight of the columns, and then we'll fix a rate. Say for instance rate is half. Okay, so you can fix a rate to be half. Okay, from these two you can compute what wr will be. Okay, can you do that? Let me see. Get an approximation for what wr is. You can't get the exact value, there's some other things that will come in, but you can get a bound on, you can get a nice relationship for wr. Okay, you can say something can be guaranteed. Okay, how do you do it? Okay, so remember the number of rows was n times wc by wr. Assuming all the rows are linearly independent, what's the rate of the code? One minus wc by wr, right? So do you get that? Okay, so maybe I should add it here. I'm sorry, I should add it here. The rate of the code is, I'll say, equal to what? Number of one minus number of rows of h divided by number of columns of h, right? That's the definition for rate, right? You can't just divide the number of rows of h divided by the number of columns. That's the rate of the dual, right? Assuming all the rows are linearly independent, this will work out to n minus n times wc by wr divided by n, which will be 1 minus wc by wr. So what will happen if the rows are not linearly independent? What will happen to the rate if the rows are not linearly independent? Will it go up or go down? It can only increase. So this number 1 minus wc by wr is a lower bound on the rate. So if they are not linearly independent, in general you can say rate is greater than or equal to this. Okay. So in most cases when you randomly constructed, you'll say maybe rate will be marginally higher. So we can take 1 minus wc by wr to be the designed rate of the code. Okay, so I'll call it the rate of the code. Okay, so it's assumed that 1 minus wc by wr will be the rate of the code. If at all there's some linear dependence, when you randomly construct, it'll be only 1 or 2 and it won't change much if n is very large. Okay, if n is very large, it won't change the rate too much. So we'll say 1 minus wc by wr is the rate. Okay, there can be a small change there, but it will not be significant in the random construction. So once I say wc is 3 and I want rate half, what will wr be? 6. Okay, so this implies, so this is the design rate. Okay, wr is 6. Okay, is that clear? So for what block length n can I construct a 3, 6 or a WC equals 3 and WR equals 6 regular LDPC code? Can I construct it for all n, or is there some restriction on n? N has to be even. How did I get that? N times WR by W6 has to be a integer, but can it be any even number? No, it has to be sufficiently large even number. Okay, you can't have n equals 2. Okay, obviously I can't construct WR equals 6. Okay, I won't have weight 6 rows in my parity check matrix. Okay, n has to be sufficiently large, and in addition it has to be even. If it's not even, I can't satisfy both those constraints of weight of column being 3 and weight of row being 6. Okay, so usually what you do is, when you want to specify this code will be denoted as a 3, 6 regular LDPC code. Okay, so this is notation. Okay, so I'm saying it's 3, 6 regular LDPC code. So you should remember, this is not even a code. Okay, what is this actually? It's just telling you a set of codes. Okay, so remember that always. Okay, it's never a code. Okay, whenever people say LDPC code, it's always a set of codes. Usually it's a set of codes and there's some randomness built into it. And the understanding is that any one code you pick from that, as long as it's random enough,
it's likely to be good. Okay, I've not proven all those statements, but we will see some analysis for why that is so. Okay, so that's the way to interpret definition of LDPC codes. Nobody will actually specify the exact LDPC code. It'll only say some kind of a weight like this. It'll say every column should have so much weight, every row should have so much weight, and you go and generate for a particular n large enough, say n equals 1000 or something. You can generate 1000, 500, 36 regular LDPC code. Okay. And that we are saying is likely to be good. Okay, I've not shown it to you. I've not even told you how to decode it. Okay, so I've just said this is the construction. Okay, so it's about 10 minutes left. Okay, so is this clear? So it's very easy now. Suppose I say I want a rate 1 by 4. What will I do? Okay. So you notice a 3, 4 regular code will give you rate 1 by 4. Okay. A 3, 5 regular code will give you what? Rate 2 by 5. Okay. So you can keep on calculating like this. But you should remember, for each things, there will be some constraint on the block length. Right? What is the constraint for 3, 4? N should be what? N should be a multiple of 4, right? Right? So the understanding is you will only pick those kinds of n for large enough n. Okay? Right? If you pick n to be very small, you have to worry about the combinatorics. Can I have an actual construction with 3 ones and 4, 3 ones in the column, 4 ones per row? The combinatorics might not work out. Okay? Once you go to large enough n, it will work. Okay? It's possible. Okay? So there will be at least one. You can prove all those things. There will be lots of codes like this. Okay? So that's why the assumption here always is, you choose an n such that WCn by WR is an integer, okay, and then n is large enough. Yeah, and reasonable n itself you can do it. So you don't have to go to really, really large n, like 10,000 or 20,000 or something. Reasonable n, you can do it. It's not too bad. Okay. But it depends on WR and WC. Okay. Suppose now I say I look at a 3,30 code. What is the rate, design rate that I can get? 0.9, right? I get a 0.9 rate. But for this 3,30, you might have to go to a large n. Okay. Right. The only constraint that will come is n should be a multiple of 10. But you'll have a tough time constructing a n equals 50 code which will satisfy 3,30. It may not be that easy. Okay, so you might have to go to a large one. First of all, n equals 50, it won't even be sparse, right? So you'll have to go to a large n to make it sparse. So maybe 1000 is not a bad idea. Okay, or maybe 5000 is not a bad idea. Okay, so you do all that, you can get this code. So the understanding is always there. You pick an n large enough to get that. Okay, so these are regular LDPC codes, and most regular LDPC codes, you'll see the good ones will have WC equals 3. Okay, so that's it. Okay.
Given the name WC and WR, would you really kind of come up with a matrix which?
Okay, so that's the next thing I'm going to talk about. Okay, so how do you construct it? There are several ways of constructing it. So I'll provide two constructions, and I think maybe we'll have time for one today. Maybe the other one we'll see tomorrow and we'll pick up from there. Okay. So how do you construct? Suppose I pick an n large enough so that I know, I at least know intuitively that it should be possible. How do I actually go about constructing it? One construction is due to Gallagher. In fact, LDPC codes, by the way, were introduced. The regular LDPC codes were introduced by Gallagher in, so let me say, introduced by Gallagher in 60s, okay, in his PhD work, he introduced LDPC codes in the 60s, okay. So he gave a construction for regular LDPC codes. So this is Gallagher's construction, which we will see next. Okay, so you know it's enough if you choose n such that WR divides WC times n, okay. But Gallagher's construction works when WR divides n. Okay, so this will require WR itself to divide n. Okay, so that will be one further restriction, but it's a very simple construction. It will work in a very, very nice way. Okay, WR has to divide N. Okay, so I'll move on to the next page to show you how this construction works. Okay, so the parity check matrix for an N WC WR LDPC matrix. Okay, so matrix is, according to the Gallagher construction, is constructed as follows. Okay, so I'll fix WC to be 3, okay, just for convenience. Okay, for other things also it will work. This is really no problem, and there's no reason why you should fix it to be 3. Okay, it will work. Okay, and I'll say some R equals N by WR. Okay. Okay, so maybe not R, I don't know, some L, okay, some number. I know that is an integer, right? I said it will work only for WR, N dividing, N being a multiple of WR. Okay, what I'll do is, I'll take this overall parity check matrix and divide it into L parts, okay? So, row 1 through row L will be one part. Row L plus 1 through 2L will be another part, okay? Did I get that right? Okay. Okay. So likewise, how many will you go to? What will be the last? How many number of rows do you have? Okay. Number of rows is WC times L, right? Okay. So it will go all the way to WC times L. Okay. So how many such parts will you have? WC parts. Okay. You will have WC parts and each of these things. Okay. So I'll call this H1, I'll call this H2, if I do dot dot dot, the last part will be HWC. Okay, so I'll show you how to construct H1, okay, and you'll see other things will work out. Okay, H1 is constructed as follows. Okay, the first row will contain WR ones put in a sequence. Okay, the second row will contain again WR ones, but starting from the next column here. The third row will contain WR ones, so on till the last one. How do I know I can divide N into WR? WR parts? Because I know WR divides N. Okay. Okay, so each of these things are WR ones. Once this will be L in length, this will be N. There is no, I'm going to come to it. Okay, so how do you construct H2? You randomly permute the columns of H1. Okay, how do you construct H3? Again, another random permutation of the columns of H1. How do you construct HWC? Okay, I don't know why I said I'm picking WC to be 3. I've not used that at all. Okay, so how do you construct HWC? Another random permutation of the columns of H1. Okay. Will it satisfy all the properties I want? Yeah. Each column will have exactly WC once. Each row will have exactly WR once. Okay. You needed the additional assumption that WR has to divide N. Okay. So this is one ensemble. You can call it the one set of LDPC codes for a particular case. This is according to the Gallagher construction. Yeah, usually you can pick it at random. Okay, is this construction clear? Okay, so maybe we'll see an example of this in the next class. I'll show you a very simple example for small numbers. At that point, it'll be slightly more clear. But this is Gallagher's construction. We'll pick up from an example from here in the next class. There's also other constructions for the most general case, which we will use actually. So I'll use the other construction also. Because for theoretical analysis, this construction is a little bit difficult. Okay, there is another construction which is easier for theoretical analysis. I'll do that, but that's a little bit more abstract. We'll slowly come to it. Okay.